Good afternoon, brethren. Where I'm at, sermon is going to be in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8, 5, and 6. One Lord and one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through and through all, and in you all. Now I'll have a prayer before Brother Matt comes up. Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that Brother Matt will have strength to do his sermon, and I pray that he will be faithful to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
The last time I led our Bible class, we were in this fourth chapter of Ephesians concerning the unity of the body, and we only had enough time to get about halfway through this, and so I wanted to continue this thought. This is a good line of reasoning. These rock-solid, unchanging aspects of the truth, which when considered serve to bolster our confidence and our assurance. To focus our view upon things that are and things that will be instead of things that might be or things that could be. Now, I just want to mention this briefly as I begin. I don't want to dwell too much on it, that all of these things I'm going to talk about today are things that have been, for the most part, clouded. Have been spoken about really sloppy in our day. Well, just for example, there's a lot of religious chatter talking about making Jesus your Lord. You know, the text says there's one Lord, there is one Lord. You know, there's a lot of chatter about these things. Or there's a lot of chatter of faith as the body of doctrine. Or, you know, more vaguely, generically talking about, well, we all have faith, you know. But there's one faith. That's what we're going to be talking about today. Or there's a lot of talk about the different forms of baptism, you know, sprinkling, water baptism, the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Mormons even talk about baptism for the dead. There's one baptism. That's what we're going to be talking about today. These are very foundational terms and concepts which the brethren here are very familiar with, but it's good to reaffirm these things. It's good for us to be able to talk about these things that are established, to be able to stir up our pure minds by way of remembrance, as our brother Benjamin told us this morning. So we'll be in the sixth verse specifically, one Lord, one faith, and one baptism. There is one Lord. Now, this is something which seems to have escaped many in our day when they think of Jesus, that Jesus is the Lord Jesus, the Christ, the chosen one of God. That there is one supreme commander, as it were, under whom all serve under his banner, who is the blessed and only potentate. You know, people say this a lot, that he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, but you really think about that. He is the Lord. What does that mean? This is not like a figurehead title. Someone is a stand-in who's given a whole lot of authority, but he doesn't really do much with that authority. This is a Lord that he's been given the highest authority because he is the most qualified to use that authority to fulfill the will and the purpose of God. Jesus is now currently reigning at the right hand of God over the affairs of men. He is the governor among the nations. It was prophesied of him truly in the ninth chapter of Isaiah. The government is upon his shoulders now, presently. All things have been made subject to him. And incidentally, this is why he was able to make that promise to the Laodiceans in Revelation, where he says, to him that overcometh will I grant to sit in my throne, with me in my throne, even as I am overcame, and I am set down with my Father in his throne. In the 18th chapter of Hebrews, this is the way he says it, who is set on the right hand of the throne. So you don't have to make Jesus your Lord. He is Lord. So really, we are acknowledging the truth and the fact that Jesus is Lord. He is the King of Kings. You know, for those who've been in the faith for some time now, I'm sure you've heard it said and seen it written a lot, Jesus is Lord, you know. And I'm afraid the significance of that has gotten away from a lot of people, and not just unbelievers. You know, they have no concept of what that means anyways. But this is something that whole throngs of religious people have failed to properly recognize. And especially in a society where we are very unfamiliar with the concept of a king because of a democracy. Many people, to be able to gain converts, they talk about Jesus as a glorified buddy. As somebody who's just kind of there for you when you need him. He's always there for you to help you out with your problems. And without coming out and saying it, he's really treated more as your servant, as somebody to serve. But in contrast, he exists in reality, highly exalted, the King of Kings at the right hand of the Majesty on high, to whom belongs honor and praise and glory. There's one Lord. And when you think of Jesus, it behooves you to think of him in this way. It will save you both from wrong thinking, and it'll actually help you to not become discouraged. Jesus is not just some man who gave his life for yours. And I'm sure you've heard a lot of example stories that have been used in sermons, you know, about a soldier giving his life for his fellow man. Or there was one I heard when I was in Bible camp when I was younger about a man who went out to save, some Coast Guard man went out to save children in the river. And he went back and forth and saved all these children and gave up his own life in the process, you know. Well, however honorable that may be, this is not the way we should be thinking when we think about Jesus. Jesus was not a man. Jesus was the Son of God, the one who prior to his incarnation into the world was God and was with God. This is one who actually participated in the formation of the worlds, whose going forth are from old, even from everlasting. This is who we're talking about. We're not just talking about a man who gave up the prerogatives of deity and came down to be as a servant, who willingly put himself within the realm of his own creation. The Son of God paid the price for your sins. Amen. You need to think about him in this way. And he isn't a mere martyr who gave his life and is now dead. He's at the right hand of the Father. He's alive. He was crucified at the hands of wicked men. He was mocked and he was spat upon and scourged and cursed and subject to the abuse of a mere man. But that's not where he stayed. And when we think of Jesus, we ought not to think of him primarily as a suffering Savior, but as a reigning King, as one who died for our sins. But he is a reigning Savior appearing at the right hand of God with his own blood for us. He is now praised and lauded. He is now sitting in a place of honor and in a place of power. And now he rules and reigns over all. There is one Lord, and that is Jesus Christ. Now for those who are without, this is a sobering thought, to be sure. It was one that the Apostle Peter, you remember, he chose to bring this up when he spoke to the people in on Pentecost, in the second chapter of Acts. Therefore let all the house of Israel know assuredly that God hath made that same Jesus, that Jesus that you killed and crucified, whom you have crucified, both Lord and Christ. And you can imagine how it must have felt. They must have felt when this really came home to them, in the hearts of the minds of the people there, when it really sank in, when they realized what they had done, the fear, the shame, the remorse. And really, you experienced the same thing in measure whenever it dawned upon you. Yes. And you realized the price that was paid on your behalf. Amen. That it was because of you that Jesus had to die. The Prince of Life, the Lord of Glory, Jesus Christ, he gave his life for you so that you might have life. Now, on the other side of that, for those of us who are in him, who've been buried into his death and raised to walk in newness of life in him, the declaration of this truth can have a different effect on us as well. The one in whom our life is hid is actually the King of Kings. So the one who is our advocate with the Father, the one who intercedes on our behalf, is over everything. What kind of confidence does that give you when you think about that, brethren? That there's nothing that's not subject unto the one with whom we have to do. There's no circumstance of life that we go through that's not managed and controlled by the exercise of his power and his dominion. That's a good thought, brethren. This being said, the one Lord whom we've been given to reign and rule over us is been done so for a very specific purpose. He's been given this dominion and this power for the fulfillment of a certain divine initiative. Namely, as he says in Ephesians chapter 1, that he's been placed far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come. And he's put all things under his feet for this purpose now and gave him to be the head over all things to the church. So Jesus is currently, as it were, the chief administrator of the salvation of mankind. For the purpose of fulfilling his will regarding this salvation, God has placed under Christ all things to do as he will, chiefly to provide this unique and tailored environment that is required for the formation of the church to take place as God desires it to be. And even now as we speak, Jesus is at the right hand of the Father, reigning, interceding on our behalf, acting as a propitiation for our sins, working with the Spirit in the hearts and minds of individuals, working out the times and the circumstances. See, there's a lot that's involved with this. This is what Jesus is doing. He's not just sitting up there. When it says that he was made to sit on the right hand, that's not a place of inactivity. That's being placed into strategic spots where he can use that power and that dominion towards the... So whatever it is that you're going through in the present, you can reason rightly considering this truth, that God is actually managing it through his Son and the operation of his Spirit to your ultimate benefit. Now, before we go into this next word, as we considered that there is one Lord, I also want to add to this that there's one kingdom over which this Lord is reigning. And I wanted to say this somewhat in relation to what's often said about a coming earthly kingdom, but also by means of encouragement to know this, that when you were saved from this present evil world and when you were delivered from the power of darkness, that you were brought into this kingdom, into this sphere of influence and reign. He testifies of this in the first chapter of Colossians when he says, who delivered us from the power of darkness and what? Translated us into the kingdom of his dear Son. Now, although this kingdom has not reached its full import as it will in the ages to come, there's a very real sense in which we are participating in it presently, in which we are partaking of its first fruits now. We are not waiting for the time in which Jesus will reign in some coming earthly kingdom. Rather, we are participants now in the kingdom. It just will be realized in its fullness when the veil, as it were, of this present evil world is taken away and all things are made new. So we're actually presently receiving of real substance, of the actual things from that coming time. We presently have eternal life. We've been made to be partakers of the nature that will actually be our soul nature in the world to come. We've actually been set in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, in our spirits, where we'll actually one day be physically in his presence. So there are very real things that we are partaking of now that are of the kingdom. Now, I say this to affirm that there was actually a transfer. There was a real translation that occurred when we were put into Christ Jesus. I have a fear that there's too much of a propensity for people to talk about this in some kind of figurative language, like it's just some kind of metaphor or something. But when we think of ourselves in Christ, we ought to realize this, that we were once living in sin. We were once wholly participating in our citizenship in the world and living according to our inherited sinful Adamic nature. And if it were not for God, that's where we would be today. It was required that the Lord of glory reach into our lives and grant us faith to believe. It required that one who was stronger than our captor to spoil the tempter and set the captives free. And as we fell upon him and responded to the call to God in obedience and in faith, it was his kingly edict that granted unto us heavenly citizenship and a means to live according to a new nature and a new heart and a new mind. This was the operation of God. This was the Lord. It required the Lord. So there is one Lord. And he affirms here that there is one faith. In several places, it's referred to as the faith of Christ Jesus. That is to say, not merely us putting our faith in Jesus, but in reference to the kind of faith, and a reference to the manner and the genesis of this faith. The faith that is given to us of God in Christ Jesus. This is why Jude refers to it as the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. In his epistle to the Philippians, Paul says that it is given in the behalf of Christ to believe on him. In his letter to Titus, Paul calls it the faith of God's elect. So this emphasizes a divine choice, a purposed and intentional granting of faith to the individual. It is something outside of ourselves that is given unto us for the purpose of participating in this purpose that God is working out in the earth. It is a power of insight and perception that causes persuasion and action above and beyond anything that we are capable of in our fleshly hearts and minds. Now, I'm sure that we've all heard men talk like this about how everyone has faith. Some choose to put their faith in Buddha, and some choose to put their faith in Muhammad. But I choose to put my faith in Christ. But that's not what we're talking about when we talk about one faith. And this is just something that I've, in my own self, I in my own vocabulary, I've chosen to sanctify this word faith as to be used exclusively in reference to the faith of Christ Jesus, as to not be confusing. Now, there's a lot of words that have been taken and perverted for their own purposes in the world. And I think it's time that we reclaim these words. We'd say that's not a worldly word. That's a Bible word, and we're going to use it as it's used in Scripture. Now, I understand that everyone is convinced of something. Everyone believes something or another to be the truth. But when we talk about the faith of Christ Jesus, there is one faith. The faith. In this context, not all men have faith. To have faith, it involves being persuaded, to be sure, but it is more than just an intellectual persuasion, an intellectual assent to the gospel. When men are convinced of something, the reality of something in the flesh, their conviction comes from a collection of their senses, from what they can see, what they can touch, what they can hear and smell, what makes sense to them and their own powers of human, earthly intellect and knowledge. But faith is not on this wise, because it involves things that are transcendent to the physical reality around us. It actually reaches into our heart and our affections. Faith is able to communicate with our spirit. And Hebrews 11, and this is probably the most common definition of faith if you had to define it, that it is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. This is something that we're very familiar with. It is our connection to the spiritual. It what confirms to us the truth of these things. It's impossible for us to prove the truth by means of physical, tangible evidence, because these things aren't on that kind of a level. However, when we speak of the unseen realities that exist all around us, for example, when we talk about the promises of God in Christ Jesus, although it's not really correct to refer to them as concrete, because they're not physical, you can't touch them, they're not physical, it's also not proper to call them abstract, because they aren't merely an idea. In fact, they actually exist on a more stable plane than the one in which we are currently residing. The things that are immediately accessible to our senses, although they're real, in a sense, they're temporary. But the things which we can see by faith, although they're not accessible by our senses, they're eternal. They are almost, I think it would almost be more appropriate to say they're more real than the reality in which we're in. Now, one of the primary means by which we know that these things are not mere ideas is by our ability to, in the spirit, taste and see them. That it is by faith that we are able to taste, see, there's the substance, and we are able to see, that's the evidence, that the Lord is good. By faith, we actually partake of a substance and are granted an evidence within ourselves that does not come from this world. By faith, we are able to experience unseen reality in a way that causes us to be fully convinced, to the point to where we will be moved to action by what we have seen, regardless of what men may want to say about it in the present. Or to say it more simply, the way the Scripture says it, who is he that overcometh but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? See, faith believes, and to him that believes, all things are possible. And really, even more than this, when we talk about one faith, faith is the means by which we participate in every aspect of our salvation. This is like our connection to God. We enter by faith. In Philippians, the first chapter, he calls it the faith of the gospel. It's associated with our acceptance of the record that God has given of his Son. It is for this reason we don't have to argue about scriptural inerrancy. If that conversation has to be had, then we got something else that we have to deal with before we can get to this issue. We are given to see God and what he has done in his Son through believing his word by faith. And actually, it's our faith in the operation of God in baptism that precipitates our entrance into him. So we are in Christ. We are justified in him as we believe the record that God has given of his Son. And as we continue to walk by faith, we hope for what is to come by faith. So we enter by faith, we continue by faith, and we look forward towards the end of these things by faith. It is by faith that we are able to, as Abraham did, stagger not at the promise of God, but we can believe that he who promised is able to perform what he has promised. So then lastly here, he talks about one baptism. Now I remember when the truth of this first struck me, and I saw it clear that, especially concerning this text, that he puts baptism in the same category as one Lord and one God and one Spirit. And I just thought, well, this is a pretty serious matter then. I want to make sure that I don't say something wrong about this, because he's putting baptism right next to one Lord. That's a pretty foundational truth, you know. And there's as I was younger in some of the churches I was in, it was just kind of like a no big deal thing, you know. Everybody had their different view of it, and it was just kind of, you know, it's baptism, you know. But this is a serious thing. If one were to call every church in the phone book and ask them, you know, what do you believe about baptism? What do you think? You know, this is being quite charitable. I don't think that there would be this unanimous consensus as it's spoken of here, that there's one baptism, you know. Just as there is one Lord and one God who instituted this baptism, there is one baptism. And it's a very crucial event in this personal aspect of each individual's experience in coming to God through Christ. I said something about this earlier, and you hear a lot of talk. Well, what form of baptism is correct? You know, should we be sprinkled or immersed? Is infant baptism okay? What about the baptism of the Holy Ghost? You know, I think you could probably spend a whole lot of unfruitful time talking back and forth about how it is you should go about it and miss the whole point. That there are not various forms of baptism. Baptism is the form. And there is one operation of God by which this takes place. And the scriptures, if you're honest, really the scripture's pretty clear on this matter. And in fact, it wasn't but a few years ago that I sat through a baptism where the preacher addressed the church about the woman he was about to baptize, and he said, "Now, baptism doesn't save us. We already know that she is saved and accepted in Christ, and this is just a public demonstration of her faith." He missed it. Yeah. He missed it, and all the people who were in there missed it. That's right. That wasn't a baptism, that was a dunking. Just as a means of a clarification, there's three brief texts that I want to read that they speak about it pretty specifically. And firstly, in 1 Peter, he makes a connection between those who were in the ark being saved by water. And he continues and says, "The like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us." And not by the putting away the filth of the flesh. That is, this isn't just a ceremony. We're not talking about a ceremonial washing, but of an answer of a good conscience towards God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So just there you can see there's some power associated with this. He talks about this. It's pretty similar in both these texts. "Buried with him in baptism, wherein also you are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God." So you see, this is something that God is doing. Amen. As we believe in what God is doing, this is how it's performed. And in Romans 6, saying pretty much the same thing, "Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even also we should walk in newness of life." Now, to anyone honest looking at this, considering baptism as it's spoken of, in the context of John the Baptist, for example, and the connection between being buried and raised again, you just have to have some kind of ulterior motive to say that baptism doesn't constitute going under the water and coming back up. It just seems pretty obvious to me. Well, your baptism is the point of contact by which God puts you in Jesus Christ. I don't know why it took me so long to see it as clearly as I wanted to, but a Brother Given series on looking back on your baptism, if you've never heard it before, I would recommend that you listen to that. That's something that made it a little bit clearer to me. And he did a really good job expounding this at this last year's renewal, too, that baptism to the believer is what a birth is to an infant. But the new birth is like unto the formation of life and birth in the natural order, in that way that the Spirit has been doing the groundwork, so to speak. In the heart and the mind, faith has been given. There's signs of life. Amen. That's measurable. But the birth is the actual new birth is when you are baptized into Him. It is a point in time where you can look back and you can distinguish when one life ended and when a new life began. Yes. And it really grieved me as I thought about this, about how many people have been robbed of this in our day. I really fear that there's a whole host of people who had genuine signs of real life in them, and they actually had a positive reaction to the truth, and somebody convinced them they didn't need to be baptized. Yeah. And they actually fell back. I'm convinced that this has happened somewhere at some time. And I can see why the Lord did this the way that He did it, for the purpose of confidence and yes, realizing who we are. We need help remembering things. We really do. And so He did this with our frame in mind so that we could remember. And I thought about it within my own life. I'm not sure I could really pinpoint the point at which the Spirit began to work in my heart and mind and when I kind of started turning towards the truth. But I can remember my baptism. So that was a fixed point in time where I knew that the Lord had done something. As it concerns our own confidence and assurance, we need this point to look back where we were sure and we were confident of the Lord's favor and blessing towards us. Yes. When we were grafted into the vine, as we were joined to Christ, when the operation of God took place, and when we knew, even though we may not have been able to express it with any measurable of clarity, and a lot of people, you know, at that point in time, you may not be able to, but there was this testimony within your own spirit that you knew you were clean. You knew you were accepted in Jesus Christ. And I praise God for an assembly like we have here, anywhere where a person is baptized and there are people, veterans of the faith, who can tell them what's happening when they're being baptized. That is a great aid to you to be able to know what happened in your baptism. So in closing, brethren, I was edified as I looked into this. These three things that we spoke about today, they are things from which we can derive much confidence and assurance. That the fact that there is one Lord that has been put in charge of the affairs of men, over the building project of God, as it were, the one whom you have been put in is head over all things to the church. That's a confidence that you can have. The one in whom your life is hid, He's Lord and He's King, and there's nobody who's above Him. That can give you some confidence. And also the fact that there's one faith, that if you are believing in Christ today, it is because the Lord has granted you faith to enter into this heavenly economy. That you don't ever have to rely on your own earthly physical senses to be able to figure things out. You know, that's a blessing, brethren, that the Lord has given us a revelation of His own purpose and will, and He's actually granted unto us the means to be able to understand and to be able to enter into this. That's a blessing. That can give you confidence. And lastly, that the point at which one enters Christ is not like a nebulous thing. Could you imagine that? If God left this up to man, you know, He didn't leave it up to man. He has an operation that He does. This is the point at which somebody comes into Christ. I'm glad that that's clarified, that that's not an ambiguous kind of thing. So from start to finish, we can see the working of our Lord and fulfilling His purpose towards us. Thank you, brother.